Thank you all for coming once again to our weekly Bible study centered on the faith of the Dead Sea Scroll people. This week we're going to be continuing the teaching where we left off last week, but before I get to that, I want to see right now if you guys have any initial questions about on any topics. So if you have any questions, please, now is the time to share them with me, typing them in the box. If you don't have any right now, then you could later on feel free to ask questions later on, and I'll try to address them. Basically, the idea is, even if I'm teaching something, if you have a question about anything, even if it's not related to what I'm talking about, feel free to just ask, because it's very often that something someone says can cause you to remember or think of other things which are not related at all. It doesn't seem to be related at all, but it just causes you to remember something. And so something I say might jog your memory towards some other topic unrelated, but it's a question that might come to your mind. So just feel free to ask any questions that come to your mind as I do the teaching. But otherwise, I am continuing the teaching from last week. So where we left off last week is right before the coming of the Messiah. And so we're gonna begin with the Messiah, the events about the Yeshua, or however you pronounce his name, the coming of him. We're gonna discuss how that relates and the history of that. But first, Laura asks a question. It's a follow-up from the previous study that we did. One of the previous studies, she asked a question, and I answered it, but she felt that there was a couple things that she wasn't sure about in my answer that wasn't clarified for her. So she's asking again about, she says, can you tell me what the difference is between evil spirits and the demons? Are they the same thing? So basically, an evil spirit, that's pretty basic of any spirit that is evil is an evil spirit. So, you know, you've got humans, they have spirits, and if they're evil, they have evil spirits. But it also includes demons, and it includes fallen angels. Angels who have sinned and rebelled against God. So the difference between evil spirits and demons is that evil spirits is a broader range, and it just refers to evil entities. Demons, on the other hand, are the spirits and souls of the children of angels who sinned and fell. So the demons are the spirits of the dead Nephilim, and they all died. They died in a civil war of the giants before the flood. Most of them died in that, the civil war of the Nephilim. It includes the giants, but it also includes the other hybrids and abominations that were the children, the offspring of the Watchers, according to Jubilees and Enoch, and some of the Dead Sea Scrolls. That story is told of them fighting each other and resulting in the death of most of the Nephilim. This story was told in the Book of Giants, for example, or the Book of the Nephilim, which was found in fragments in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And so, and then after the flood, the dead spirits. The spirits of those dead Nephilim, they didn't go to Sheol. They did not go to the prison of angels, of the fallen angels. They didn't go to the prison. They were allowed to remain on the earth. Oh, and the flood, any remaining Nephilim that were on the earth were wiped out in the flood. So after the flood, the Nephilim were given a law by an angel of God, And this angel basically told them, you're going to be allowed to remain on the earth as long as you follow some rules. If you don't cross a certain line, we'll let you stay here. And we won't put you in prison. We'll let you stay here until the very end. So they agreed to those terms, and they were given their jobs and missions of executing justice and punishing those who deserve to be punished. And they were doing such a good job and harming so much of the world who had sinned, and they basically, the children of Noah were begging Noah for mercy to help somehow. And so Noah asked God for help, and God said, I'm going to help. I'm going to send them all to prison. All the demons are going to be banished. However, Satan, or Mestima, as the Book of Jubilees and the Book of Noah describes, he basically comes to God and says, you cannot do this. You can't send them all away because you have already told us what your will is, and your will is to punish these people and to lead them astray as they deserve. And so if you do this, we won't be able to fulfill that requirement that you have appointed to us. And so then God followed the advice of what Satan said, but here's what it says. Only not all of them were sent away. It was he compromised. Basically, he said, there's too much corruption and power by these demons. So what we're going to do is most of them are going to be banished into and imprisoned into the prison. However, 1/10, 10% of these demons, they will be in your hands to do with as has been appointed to you. And so basically, to clarify what Satan's role is, according to these documents, basically, Satan is a fallen angel who rebelled against God. However, he doesn't realize he rebelled against the Most High. He rebelled against the representative of the Most High. Like, for example, in the Book of Genesis, you see God walking through the garden. Well, that's not the Most High walking through the garden, because the Most High cannot even be approached. He is above all conception. So the one who was in the garden is the angel of Yahweh, the angel of Yahuwah. And that is the representative of God. And he is, I believe he is Yahuwah. And he is the representative of the Most High. And so Satan does not realize he's opposing the Most High. He thinks he's actually serving the Most High and a follower of the Most High. He, however, opposes the Creator. He opposes the representative that acts on the Most High's behalf. However, he knows that this Creator that he opposes has a lot of power and influence, and that ultimately the Most High chose this Creator, whom Satan believes is corrupt, but he chose that Creator for a purpose. And so basically he's trying to protect himself, and he knows that he could be sent to prison too. He doesn't want to be sent to prison. And so he was basically given a deal by the Creator. And the Creator said, if you work for me, I'll let you stay here and won't send you to prison. And if you do this work for me, then you'll be spared. And what was the work that God, or the representative, commissioned him to do? And that work is punishing the wicked with what they deserve. He was appointed as the angel of death, and so he is actually doing a lot of service to God and obeying him and what he requires. Satan, however, has an agenda behind the scenes that he's also trying to sin as well. So he's not purely good, but there is a goodness to him because he is useful for the purpose that has been assigned to him. And so Satan is the prince of demons, but Satan is not a demon himself. He is a fallen angel. But so that's the understanding of the Dead Sea Scroll faith, of what demons are, what the fallen angels, how Satan fits all into this. Now, as for the serpent is not Satan. Someone asked the question about the serpent, Lucifer, and Satan. Are they all the same? And the serpent is an actual animal that was chosen by Satan. Satan possessed the serpent. This is what some of these documents tell us. Lucifer, on the other hand, I would say he's one and the same with Lucifer. However, I'm not certain about the name Lucifer being the actual name of Satan or referring to Satan. But I assume when you say Lucifer that you're talking about the evil being, and basically the chief evil being is Satan, and he's known by various names: Belial, Mastema, Beelzebub. So there's all different kinds of names for this evil entity. But now, if you guys have other questions, please share. But if not, then I'm going to go and continue the teaching from last week. So let's see here. So last time, I discussed how there were jubilees. According to the Testament of Levi, I read about 10 jubilees all the way up to the Messiah's coming. So now, the 10 jubilees that Levi, the son of Jacob, prophesied to us in his testament, this points up all the way to the year 1 BC. The Messiah was born on the first day of Hanukkah, as I've shared with you guys in some other teachings about when he was born, on the first day of Hanukkah rather than during Tabernacles. This is stated in the Bible, the books of the New Testament of the Ethiopian Bible. And so I trust that this date is correct, that he was truly born on the first day of Hanukkah and in the year 1 BC. There are documents which convince me that he was born in the year 1 BC. These documents, they date his birth according to the Greek year. Like, you know how we date our years. We say, right now this is 2015 AD. That's using a special year system. In the ancient times, there were other systems of chronology used for eras. There was one that was very prominent in ancient times, and that was the Greek reckoning. And that was dating all the way back to the time of Alexander the Great. So Alexander the Great, he began his empire, which Daniel prophesied of. And so this empire that was begun was the beginning of the Greek chronology, the time. So they would say year one in the kingdom of the Greeks, year two. And every new year would be the, just like we say AD, next year is going to be 2016 AD. How the Greeks did it, it did the same way, only they did it in the year of the Greek. So it'd be like KG or something like that. They didn't use those initials, KG, but I'm just giving an example. Kingdom of Greeks, you know, it's... So there are documents, extra documents, in the name of the apostles, which I believe are scripture and truly written by these men. And these documents date when the Messiah was born according to the year of the kingdom of the Greeks. And this matches up with the year 1 BC. We find that in the first, I think it's 2nd Maccabees. Yeah, 2nd Maccabees. The years in 2nd Maccabees are dated according to the kingdom of the Greeks in the book 2nd Maccabees as well. Now, someone is asking me a question. Yeah. About Hanukkah. So the whole issue of the calendar is very complex. But there's two categories. There's the solar calendar and the lunar calendar, and then there's separate divisions, different ways of doing the solar, different ways of doing the lunar. How I believe it is to be done, and how the Dead Sea Scrolls teaches it is to be done, is you follow the solar calendar of 364 days, and it's always going to be on Tuesday evening. It's going to begin, the first day of Hanukkah is always going to begin Tuesday evening every year. And this year, it begins this Tuesday evening. And it lasts 8 days. So that's according to the Dead Sea Scroll calendar perspective, with the first day of the week beginning on Saturday evening. Because according to the Book of Jubilees, for instance, the day begins the evening before, begins the evening, not in the morning. And so when you follow the solar calendar, that's how it works. The reason the people, the Jews, are doing it the 6th is because they're following the lunar calendar. So it changes by variable. So let's see. Yeah, it would be the 8th. The first day of Hanukkah begins in the evening of the 8th, when the sun sets on the 8th of December for this year. It's always going to be right around this time, right around the 8th, like within a week. It'll never be more than 7 days away from December 8th. It's always going to be around that time, according to the Enoch calendar. But so, and his name was, I would pronounce it as Yeshua, or as others pronounce Yeshua, and various other pronunciations, Yehoshua, etc. And then, you know, as the Greeks, Latin, and then the English, they pronounce it as Jesus, Jesus, and then eventually it came to be Jesus in English. That is, as we know, an incorrect pronunciation, but that's the origin of this, of their, that's the same individual that we're discussing. It is the man that they call Jesus, and in Yeshua. So he was born at this time. He was the Messiah. He had a cousin named John, you know, John the Baptist. And John the Baptist was an extremely righteous man. And it is my belief that he was raised by the Essene Jews, until he became an adult. Now, when he became an adult, he was inspired by the Essene teachings. How we can see this is that so much of John's teachings, very little that we have a lot of similarities with the Dead Sea Scrolls. He was strongly emphasizing of baptism, repentance, returning in a new covenant, returning to the law, purifying your spirit and your, as well as your body, and where he baptizes is very close to where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. It's very close to that area. And he taught a type of communism, very similar as the Essenes taught, a poverty. He taught having a life of poverty. So there's a lot of similarities here which strongly connect him with the Dead Sea Scrolls. He believed that he was preparing the way of the Lord. And that's what the Dead Sea Scrolls says the Essene community was supposed to do. They went into the wilderness to prepare the way of the Lord. So where did John the Baptist get this idea? It's most likely that he saw that the community that he was raised up in was preparing the way of the Lord in the wilderness, and he felt called to do the same thing. And he said, I'm going to prepare the way in the wilderness for the Messiah. He's about to come. So he went, and He believed he was a special prophet chosen by God, and I believe he was. He was chosen to prepare the way of the Messiah in the wilderness. And so he went into the wilderness, and he formed his own denomination of the Essenes. And he preached righteousness and repentance to a crooked and wicked generation. He was an extremely holy man and was a priest. Now, there's a question was asked about John the Baptist. Is he a co-messiah? And I would not consider him a co-messiah. I also do not believe he is the teacher of righteousness, as we've heard some people teach that that's the case. I believe Yeshua is the teacher of righteousness. John was, in a sense, he was the forerunner. He was like an Elijah, a spirit of Elijah, and so he did not fulfill the role of the Messiah according to what the scriptures speak for the Messiah. Now, some of the Jews later on believed that he was the Messiah afterwards, and they formed a group where they basically honored him as their Messiah. And so, but there are documents where the apostles speak against that and prove that John was not the Messiah or a Messiah. Now, in Hebrew, Messiah means anointed. And this can refer to anyone who's anointed. It can be a king, a priest, or just anyone in general, a prophet. But when it's referring to a special figure, a leader, the Messiah term has a much deeper and more special and focused, specific meaning. It refers to a savior, a priest, a king, a divine being, a very special individual. So I don't think John was a co-messiah in that sense. Now, many of the Pharisees and Sadducees hated John the Baptist, as we see in the New Testament, as well as a few of the Essenes. We have a document called Slavonic Josephus. I believe Slavonic Josephus is probably authentic. There might be some additions added by scribes, but for the most part, I think Slavonic Josephus is legit. It was truly written by Josephus, and in Slavonic Josephus, there's extra information John the Baptist opposing Essenes, and he opposed some of the Essenes because some of them spoke vile things against him. So we have to remember that just because you're a member of a religion does not mean you're a righteous person. You could be a corrupt person, a sinful person. So not all the Essenes were righteous, we have to remember. But overall, the Essenes were very righteous compared to all the other groups. Now, David is just wondering what the topic is for tonight. And basically, the topic is... I gotta turn that off. I have a weekly set alarm, and I never have turned it off. It keeps going off when we're doing this. So sorry about that. But basically, we're doing the question and answer thing as usual. But I'm continuing last week's teaching, going through the history of the true faith, as I understand it, and pointing out and explaining the various events of Scripture. Just giving an overview of the history of our faith. And so, let's see, most of the people of Judah, the land of Israel, loved John the Baptist and considered him a true prophet and a holy man of God. It was just, you know, there was a large portion of the Pharisee and Sadducee hierarchy, the leaders, the regular people in society, poor people, you know, all in general, people who don't worry about, you know, trying to debate other people or trying to be a leader over the people. Those people were more open and more embracing of John the Baptist. Now, Yeshua, the Messiah, he also studied among the Essene Jews, I believe. Between the years of 12 and 30 years old, I believe that's a lot of what he was doing. He was studying the Dead Sea Scrolls, he was studying the Scriptures, and he was preparing his future role as the Messiah. He was not yet allowed to perform his ministry publicly yet. He had to wait until he was 30 years old first. And during that time, he was working on being the best person he could be, helping people behind the scenes, and just studying and growing as a person, as a human being. And so he was convinced that he was the Messiah, and he went to John the Baptist to receive from him a priestly and political endorsement. So I believe that he did have an understanding about the politics of it. And, you know, he wasn't a politician, but at the same time, he understood that there is a support that you need. So he was seeking for John the Baptist's support, both religiously as well as politically. So he went to John the Baptist, and John baptized him on the sixth day of the 10th month of the year 30 AD. He was baptized on that day. According to the Ethiopian New Testament, that's the day that he was baptized on. Right now, we are in when the first day of Hanukkah is. Remember, that's the 25th of the ninth month. So, the Messiah was baptized on the sixth day of the 10th month. So it's like 2 weeks from now. A little bit, not exactly 2 weeks, but right around 2 weeks from now is when he was baptized, according to the Ethiopian New Testament Bible. After he was baptized, as we know from the New Testament, John became convinced that his cousin, Yeshua, was indeed, truly the Messiah. So from that point on, John began preaching to all his followers that his cousin was the Messiah. Now, Yeshua, he chose for himself 12 chief apostles. By doing so, he declared himself to be the King of the Jews. This is something very special, which people didn't realize that this was the case. But when the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, we found out that this is what Yeshua meant when he picked 12 apostles. Because in the Temple Scroll, we find that the king is required to have 12 men of Israel to follow him around everywhere, and to be his bodyguards, and to just be his counselors religiously, and they are to be his followers. And so this is exactly what Yeshua did. He picked 12 for himself, and this was declaring that this was a subtle declaration that he is the king of the Israelites. Yeshua also chose 72 other apostles. Now, the reason he chose them was because there's a special number of 100. Josephus tells us that there's a special number of 100, which forms a court. So there's the Sanhedrin, which the Sanhedrin is mentioned also in the Ethiopian Bible, the extra books of their Bible. The Sanhedrin is not just for the Jews, but it's also a New Testament thing that the apostles, they formed a new Sanhedrin for themselves. Their Sanhedrin was based on the church, or the, you know, the new believers. It wasn't based on Israel anymore, because Israel was scattered into exile, or they were about to be. Israel had become rejected. So they formed a Sanhedrin in a similar sense. And so there was the 12 apostles. There was the 72 apostles, in addition, the 72 disciples, which the gospel speaks of. It tells us about them, that he sent those men out, 72 men out. Some manuscripts say 70 were sent out. And then there was James and Simon Peter. There's James, He basically chose, he chose two other people, one of them being James. And so altogether that formed 100. I think he himself was, because he was the Messiah, he was the high priest. So he had himself, and James was the, was going to be, like a king. Or maybe it was, James was either the king or the high priest. I don't remember which, but so there was the two, the Messiah and James, and then there was the 12 apostles and the 72 apostles. Let's see. I did the math before and they added up to 100, but I might be missing something. I think I'm missing some of the numbers. I messed up the numbers. But so, at least when I studied it before, the math seemed to add up, and Yeshua was following this example of having a special group of 100 people. But I need to double check that math, because now it's not making sense at the moment to me. So I'll have to double check on that later sometime. But, and of course, in addition to these 100, he also had many other disciples and followers who desired to convert to his religion. But someone asked a question about the book of John. Are you talking about the Gospel of John? If you're talking about the Gospel of John, and the question was, is it in Greek, Hebrew, Aramaic? It was my understanding that at least a good chunk of the New Testament was written originally in Hebrew. Possibly some of it was in Aramaic. And then there is a possibility some of it was in Greek. I'm not quite sure. To some extent, you know, but it seems John was the most likely the one that the Gospel of John was most likely the written in Hebrew. Yeah, I'm not sure what you're referring to about the copy that I referred to. You're saying that I mentioned a book of John earlier and a copy or something. I don't remember what I said, what I referred to. I mentioned the Temple Scroll. I mentioned there's the Gospels, but I don't remember specifically saying the book of John. If you can remind me, if I said that, if you remember exactly what I said, then please specify and I can hopefully answer the question better. But let's see here, what else to say. So the Messiah, he traveled out throughout the land of Judah for 3.5 years. Some people say he was only 1 year or a year and a half, but there is documents which say it was 3.5 years. And I believe that's true. The book of Daniel prophesies of the Messiah's coming, and it says in the middle of a week, he'll be cut off. So halfway through, 3.5 years through. So it seems like his ministry of 3.5 years is what Daniel is referring to. And this also explains the Antichrist thing, because the Antichrist is going to be ruling for 3.5 years, remember. So, and the Antichrist is trying to copy the Messiah, doing some of the things he did. So it makes sense that if the Antichrist is doing it for 3.5 years, Yeshua also did it for 3.5 years. But so, he did that ministry for 3.5 years, and then during this time, he prophesied to the Jews and preached to them a message of repentance and purification of the heart and flesh. And he taught, and he preached to them how to be righteous in what works and faith. What works and what faith are required for salvation? He taught them the way and the path to eternal life, and he explained to them many things about the truth. He also did many miracles to prove his divinity and also to prove that he was a true and righteous man of God, and to help as many people as possible. Let's see. Okay, what was the Messiah's name you're asking about now, David? Sounds like you're asking about what was his name, like how his name was spelled. And if that's what you're asking, I don't know, because We don't have any sure way of knowing. The Dead Sea Scrolls have variants of the name of Joshua. It has different variants of how to spell it. We don't know how the parents of the Messiah spelled his name. We don't know which dialect they were using, which pronunciation. So it's kind of all up in the air as to what his actual name, how it was spelled. But we can have a good idea of what it probably was. But I don't know. I would tend to go with the longer version. So the six letter version of his name would probably be the case. Yeah. Now a question is asked. I think it's by Rhonda. She asks about the Edomites. Who are the Edomites? And who are the Jews, the true Jews? I've heard a lot of people teaching what she's referring to. She's basically heard that the black people are the original Israelites, and I have some good friends who believe that and tried to convince me of the same, but I'm convinced currently that that's not the case. I'm open to new evidence, but we've got DNA evidence which says otherwise. And we've got, David, I have two people on Skype with me, so they're asking questions there as well. You can't see the questions on the site that we're using. But, so, there's DNA which shows that these black people do not have the vast majority of these people are not of Semitic ancestry. They are strongly linked to the Ham, the descendants of Ham, Ham's line. Jews are descended from Shem, the whites, or the Europeans and the Russians. They are from Japheth. Now the problem is the Israelites were dispersed everywhere, so there were some dispersed to Africa, some to Europe, some to Asia, all over the place. But the evidence best supports that the people who claim to be the Jews today, that many of them are the true Jews, but that not all of them are. And here's one of the reasons why, because they actually say that you're a Jew if your mother was of Jew. But that's not the case. The scriptures say otherwise. It says it's the father. Jewish ancestry comes from your father. So it's very likely that a lot of people who think they're Jews are not, because it was their mother who was a Jew, and their father was some random Gentile from some other ancestry. So it's likely the case that much fewer people are actually Jews of those who claim to be Jews than is currently acknowledged. But at the same time, it seems that the Jewish people as a whole are strongly connected to the Ashkenazi, the people who are Ashkenazi Jews, and all different groups that claim to be Jews. I'm sure there are Jews mixed in their ancestry. Ethiopian Jews. We lost the people on Skype for now. Hopefully they'll be back. Yeah, the Sephardic. I would basically say if there's any Jewish community, at least some of their Jews are probably true Jews. But other communities are less Jewish than others because there's more of their people were converts rather than born into it. So I don't think that the white people are synonymous with Edom. I think that a lot of that stuff has to do with a lot of racist ideology, and there's a lot of anti-Semitism. There is a special, I truly believe that there is a spirit, and there's evil spirits at work. Basically, they are, what they try to do is, Hold on. What they try to do is make people hate the Israelites and oppose them and want bad things to happen to them. And I think it's kind of what's been happening today with like all the anti-Zionism stuff and all the anti-Israel things. Now, I'm not saying that Israel or Zionism is entirely righteous or even close to obeying the Torah. But what we do have is people cursing his people. And that's not, you know, the scriptures speak of the one who blesses his people will be blessed, and the one who curses his people will be cursed. So you really want to be careful about hating and opposing these people. Because, like, I know some people who basically are pro-Hitler, almost, essentially, and they think that the Holocaust was perhaps even a good thing, or that it was highly exaggerated how bad it was, and that it seems to me that the Jews and the Israelites are being persecuted still, and there's a lot of anti-Semitism still in the world. There's a lot of anti-Jewish people in the world, and that seems to me not to be a coincidence. Like the whole thing with the Temple Mount, of how people claim that the temple was not built on the Temple Mount, that seems to me a design by Satan to try to prevent the building of the temple. There's a lot of stuff like that which really seems to me that the enemy is hard at work to corrupt people's hearts and to oppose his people and to prevent a restoration of the one true faith. So you just got to be careful about a lot of these doctrines, because there's a lot of these doctrines, when people twist the evidence and skew it, it might seem to support what these guys are saying. But when you do more study, you're going to start seeing inconsistencies in some of what they're saying. And yeah, you can take a DNA test to see what your ancestry is. And the DNA is going to keep on getting better and better as we advance in our technology. Now, the question is asked by Laura, what is the difference of the Jews and Israelites? You know, Israelites just refers to all of the 12 tribes, but it's also used to refer to just the 10 lost tribes. The Jews, it's referring to the kingdom of Judah, all the people who are Israelites who are part of that kingdom. So it's predominantly Jews and Levites. Some Benjaminites. Okay, she's calling back. Oh, that's okay. Can you mute it again? Good to have you back. Can you mute your microphone? Yeah, sometimes we have problems with Skype. I was just answering a little bit more about what you had asked. And then now someone is asking about the difference between Jews and Israelites, so I was answering that. I'm going to go back to the teaching that I was doing. Let's see here. So, after all his ministry he did, the Messiah, in 34 AD, Judas was bribed by the wicked high priest, Caiaphas, and wicked Pharisees and Sadducees, who were betrayed by those people, to betray Yeshua. And Judas betrayed him, and through Judas's betrayal, Yeshua was murdered by the wicked priest, and the wicked Pharisees and Sadducees, and the Romans, they were involved too. Now, the Dead Sea Scrolls speaks of the wicked priest, and people like Eisenman, Jackson Snyder, and others think that the wicked priest was someone involved with James, and that James was the teacher of righteousness, but I don't think that's the case. The wicked priest, I believe, was Caiaphas. That matches what the Dead Sea Scrolls speak about the teacher of righteousness and the wicked priest and the spouting liar. That matches best. There's the teacher of righteousness being Yeshua, then there is the wicked priest being Caiaphas, and then there is the liar, which I believe is Judas. He was the betrayer. He spoke lies from his mouth. You know, the kiss. He kissed his rabbi, Yeshua, and it was a kiss of death, a traitor. And so this, to me, is he's the false speaker, the liar that the Dead Sea Scrolls speaks of. Let me see here. One second. Yeah, I believe Rhonda was speaking about something she read in a book, and one thing was Adam was made from the elements. Yes, this is the case. He was made from earth, water, the air, and fire. He was made from all that into what we have today. The body was formed from the clay, the dust, and the spirit was breathed into his nostrils. And in the DNA, I do believe there is a code in the DNA, but that I wouldn't say it has Yahuwah's DNA written in, but it has his imprint in it. It has his signature? It has his signature in our DNA. But I don't think you could see, like, his name in our DNA. Like, you wouldn't see Yahuwah in our DNA, I don't think. Like, you wouldn't see in Hebrew or anything. Now, on the third day after he was killed, as we know, the scriptures speak of, Yeshua rose from the dead, and he appeared to his apostles. And he spent 40 days giving the apostles the new covenant and the new law. We're told in the New Testament that he spent 40 days with them, teaching them. But we're not told in our Bibles what he was teaching them. But we have other documents which tell us what he was teaching them. And basically, the Old Testament says, the prophet like Moses will come. And what did Moses do? He spent 40 days on the mountain, receiving the law. And the same thing was done by the Messiah for the apostles. They went on Mount of Olives, and he was giving them the new law that he had received and that he wanted them to teach to the world and in the new covenant. These are what these documents tell us. The Dead Sea Scrolls also speak of a new covenant, and these documents that were found of the New Testament extra writings, so many of their teachings, their new laws, are the same new laws that are found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. I don't think this is a coincidence. That it shows that these writers, these people who wrote the New Testament extra books of the Ethiopian Bible and other books, that they ultimately originated from the Essenes. So, the Essene Jews had already been preaching a new covenant, which had not yet been authenticated. The Messiah, however, authenticated the new covenant and gave the apostles the terms of the new covenant. After these days, these 40 days, he ascended into the heavens, and then 10 days later, he sent the Holy Spirit to empower the apostles and all pure believers. And he spent, the Messiah, according to these other writings, and according to the prophet Isaiah, he spent another year and a half after he died and rose. He spent a year and a half appearing to the apostles and giving them secret teachings and visions. And these were written down in other books. So, After this time of them receiving their secret teachings for a year and a half, he sent the apostles out into the world. He sent them out, and the apostles traveled all over Africa, Europe, and Asia in order to preach to the Gentiles the message of repentance and salvation through faith in the Messiah. Jason asks, "What did the Messiah physically walk out of the tomb, or was it like a spiritual rebirth?" I believe that he physically walked out. The Gospel of Peter, for instance, tells us that he walked out. He was when the Messiah rose, the angels went into the tomb. They rolled the tomb away and they went in, and they were carrying him out on their, like, sort of like, you know, when someone kind of like has a limb, like their legs are lame, and or they have a hard time walking, and they're like trying to hold someone else's shoulders for support, and they're being carried along. That's what the Gospel of Peter tells us. Peter, in his own words, tells us that Yeshua was helped out, leaning on them. And the cross, the cross went with them. They took the cross with them, and they all ascended into the heavens. So, I believe he physically was resurrected and came out of the tomb. Let's see. Okay. Barbara wants me to recap about what I said about the answer of the white people and the blacks and Edomites. Basically, because she got kicked out. Basically, I don't think that the black people are Israelites. I don't think the white race are Edomites. The white race is Japheth. Okay, it's Japheth. But at the same time, your race is not necessarily indicative of who you belong to, because there can be some mixture. For instance, Joseph, he married an Egyptian woman. Yet all the children of Joseph are considered Josephites or Israelites. They're not considered Egyptians, even though they are directly descended from Egypt. They have half Egypt blood in them, and yet they're considered Israelites, because over time, the race gets eliminated based on where you're living. You mix in with the people you live, and more it gets focused into who the people you marry into are. And so because the Josephites married in with the Israelites, it became more and more Israelite children. Their DNA was refined to an Israelite type of way. Now, basically, Israelites and Shemites, essentially, they're a middle position between black and white. They're like, they can be closer to black sometimes, they can be closer to white sometimes. So they're in like a middle ground. Blacks are Hamites, and whites are Japhethites. For the most part, as I said, there can be mixtures. So you can't make a general line, but I would say overall, the black people are not the Israelites, and the white people are not Edomites. Some of the Edomites might be white, but some of the Edomites also might be black. And it might be all different. It's a wide issue, which can't just be stated like all people of this group are this group, because it's just too complex, the DNA. But we can make generalizations, and generally speaking, you can't connect the Edomites to the white race, and you can't connect the Israelites to the black race. Hopefully that answers that question. And I know there are people who strongly disagree with that, and I'm going to try to be open-minded in the future. So if you have evidence to the contrary, you can always share that with me, and I can try to do my best to go through with it and be as fair as possible. Now, so as I said, the apostles were sent out, and they preached to the Gentiles the message of repentance and salvation through faith in the Messiah. Most of the Essene Jews, I believe, converted. That's why the Essene Jews like almost vanished completely, their religion, because they mostly converted to a faith by a new name. And then most of the other Jews did not convert to the faith of the apostles and the Messiah. So the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they did not really agree with their teachings. But the Essenes, on the other hand, the vast majority of them were fully convinced that Yeshua was the Messiah and that they were going to follow his path. But not all the Essenes converted, but most of them did. The ones that did not convert, they continued to follow the Old Testament way and did not accept Yeshua as a prophet. And then it eventually broke up into other heresies, which I'll mention in a little bit. But also, in contrast, many Gentiles that they preached to converted. So a large majority of the people who were converted to the faith of the Messiah were Gentiles. What I said earlier is, this is what the Gospel of Peter says, that the Messiah and the angels that came to him to bring him out of the tomb, they ascended into heaven with the cross. The apostles did not ascend into heaven. So you misheard that, what I had said. It was the angels came down, two of them, to get the Messiah out of the tomb to protect him, because they would probably try to kill him again if they found him there. So they carried him out, and then they ascended into heaven. According to Peter himself in the Gospel of Peter, which I believe was truly written by Peter. It's only the Gospel of Peter is fragmentary, and now yes, it was foretold that the Messiah would suffer and die. There are many passages in Scripture which speak of this. There are the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs is a good one. There's a lot of prophecy of what the Messiah would do in those writings. But also in our regular Bibles, you know, we've got... Oh, and Isaiah. Say Isaiah and Jeremiah. They prophesied of the Messiah's suffering that would happen and that he would die. In the future, I can go through some of those very interesting prophecies from these other books. There's some amazing stuff out there, which truly foretold of what he would suffer. The Dead Sea Scrolls has also references to what he would suffer, too. And I truly think Isaiah and the other prophets in our Old Testament also prophesy that he would suffer and die. Daniel speaks of how he would die for the people, but not for himself. I know in other translations, the Jews translate that differently, but I think that's probably the correct, accurate translation, that he would die, but not for himself. And what function? Why was the suffering necessary? My understanding of how his atonement worked was he had to be a righteous man, and he was negating sin by counteracting it. So every temptation you've ever had and you've given into sin, that's an instance of where you failed. Same for every human. They have a temptation where they failed in. And what Yeshua had to do is he had to go through every temptation himself, and he had to undo what other people did to counteract it by going through those same type of temptations, but overcoming them and being righteous. And then by the end of that all, he had to finish his life perfectly righteous, in full obedience, without any sin or flaw in his entire being. And he accomplished that. And so it wasn't inherently necessary for him to suffer. He only had to live his life in perfect righteousness. But the Father commanded him to die on the cross, to continue to walk a path which would ultimately end up on the cross, and the Father did not want to save him from the cross, and that the Messiah was supposed to obey the Father and not intervene and do any miracles to stop the plan that was given to him. And so he had to die, and this death of suffering and being murdered was to teach a lesson of prophecy and typology. So He did not have to die for our sins. He did not have to be killed for our sins. He could have just died of natural causes, I believe. Just like in the Old Testament, in the Law of Moses, we are told the high if a man accidentally kills someone, murders someone accidentally, they have to go to the city of refuge. If they leave the city of refuge, they can be killed by the avenger of blood. That's found in Deuteronomy. Now, it's in Numbers too, I think, but it also says if you leave, it says when the high priest dies, the guy who was stuck in the city of refuge can now leave the city of refuge and can no longer be killed by the avenger of blood. So you see, the high priest, it did not say the high priest has to be killed or murdered, but just when the high priest dies, you are free to leave, and you will no longer be killed if you leave. In the same way, the Messiah is our high priest, and when he dies, whichever way he dies, as long as he is a righteous priest, he enables us to leave the city of refuge that we have fled to, and we will be spared. The blood avenger will not come after this throughout the rest of the world. But if he doesn't die, and if we try to leave the city of refuge, then we will end up being killed by the avenger of blood. So he died. The way he died was not necessary, but he did have to die. Just in general, he had to die after a perfect life of being a priest and atoning for people through his righteousness and purity of body and his works. So that's kind of how I view it. Hopefully that helps explain. There's a question about, are we still under the law? Aren't we still under the law and not saved by grace alone? Basically, we're still under the law's requirements in a sense, but we're also, the new law has made some differences. Basically, under the old law, there was no provision for salvation. It basically said, if you do a willful sin, there's no atonement for you. No animals can be offered. The new covenant provides that. And so the new covenant provides what the old could not. But that does not mean that the laws of the old are no longer valid. It just means it's to be understood in the context of the Messiah's work that he did for us. So, yeah, you don't take away the law when you receive pardon. Like the president, when he gives pardon to someone, he doesn't say, okay, you guys can break the law whenever you want now. No, that would be ridiculous. You get pardoned for your crime, and then he says, okay, even though the law did not give you that chance, I pardoned you, but now you need to obey the law, and don't do that again. I spared you from the death penalty you should have had, or from your prison sentence, and now you're going to live righteously and obey the laws of the land. It's a very similar thing. So the law is not taken away. It's just there are provisions provided which weren't provided before, which allow for some pardon to be received if we repent. And if you sin, you have to repent and seek forgiveness for salvation. You don't receive salvation automatically, and just asking for forgiveness will not lead to your salvation. You have to earn your salvation by faithful works. You have to obey him with all your heart. Now, the Noahide commandments and the Ten Commandments, and there's Noahide laws, and then there's the Ten Commandments. Basically, the Jews speak. This is a question asked by Rhonda, and so the Noahide laws that the Jews say are not the same laws that Noah taught. Noah taught other laws. There is a law. There are laws of Noah, but those laws included much more than just what the Jews claim. We can see that in the Book of Jubilees and Book of Noah. There's more laws now. These were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, Jubilees and the Book of Noah, and the Ten Commandments are just they're a summary of all the laws that we have to keep. It's not intended as a you only have to keep the Ten Commandments. Don't keep any of that other stuff. You know, everything's required, but the Ten Commandments helps to give an overview. Hopefully that answers your guys' questions. Now let's see here. So when the Messiah had been murdered in the temple, or not in the temple, I can't remember if he was murdered in the actual temple, but he was murdered in Jerusalem, I'm pretty sure, if I remember correctly. And so when that happened, the veil of the temple had been torn. Now, when the Essenes saw that sign of the veil being torn, they saw this as a fulfillment of prophecy. And all of the Essenes removed their priests from the temple area, and they ceased to bring animal sacrifices there. Basically, in the Testament of Levi, Levi tells us that when the Messiah would come, he would be killed, and that the veil would be destroyed, and that would be a sign that their sacrifices and their priesthood has been rejected. So when the Essenes saw this sign, they obeyed the sign and stopped participating in the temple worship. They stopped doing the sacrifices of the animals, and they removed their priests. So they began, along with the apostles, to preach against the animal sacrifices and against the temple. Because remember, as I said last time, the temple had been abominated by Herod. It wasn't the true temple that the temple scroll commands, the law of Moses commands. They were so much impure about this temple, and unholy and unrighteous and unlawful, that it just crossed a line and there was it was no more allowed to be endorsed. They still went to the temple to try to preach to them, and they also tried to follow the rules too, like they did not do unclean things there out of respect for that place, because that place was still holy. It was chosen by Yahuwah to be his place where his name would rest, and that name rests there even without the temple being there. Or even without the temple being legitimate, that land there is still holy. So they've still respected and honored the land by being pure in their bodies. And they did not go there when they were unclean. Yeah, the Essenes, as they opposed the animal sacrifices after the veil was torn. Before the veil was torn, they did not. The Dead Sea Scrolls show the Essenes endorsing animal sacrifices. They were not all vegetarians. That's a misunderstanding that's been propagated by... there are some modern Essenes. They call themselves Essenes, but they're very different from the ancient Essenes. And they introduced vegetarianism as a requirement for all people. But the ancient Essenes did not believe that. There's no evidence in the scrolls or in the ancient writings of the apostles and the believers that it was forbidden to eat meat. Now, the land that I spoke of is, I believe, on in Jerusalem, where we have Jerusalem today. It's on Mount. The whole land of Jerusalem is holy, but also the mountain, the Mount Zion, I believe, is truly the land the Dome of the Rock, I believe that's where the temple is supposed to be built. I don't think it's a coincidence. When the Muslims came there, they built that there specifically because they believed that's where the temple was, and they were doing that as a polemic against the Jews to rub it in their face that we conquered this land, it's ours now, and we're going to take this place for us, and we're going to build our place on this. This was the ultimate disgrace that the Jews could endure, to see their place taken over. Yeah, a lot of people, when they go to Jerusalem or the holy place, the Mount area, they have divine experiences, or they experience some mystical things, I've heard. I've never been there myself, but that's what I've heard. Let's see. Now, the Essene Jews and the followers of the apostles, they began to do their own sacrifices in their communities. They did not do animal sacrifices anymore, but they did their own sacrifices in their own communities, we're told. We're told that by Josephus and Philo, ancient contemporaries of the Essenes who witnessed that they did this, that they did sacrifices. And then the extra books of the New Testament and even books in our New Testament speak of sacrifices that the apostles did, new sacrifices that the Messiah ordained in the new law and the new covenant, and these were written down. And now the Essenes, they still believed they were required to give the priest in Jerusalem their tithes and first fruits. So even though the priesthood has been rejected, and the temple and sacrifice was being rejected, they still gave their what was required to be given to the Levites, because that's a command in the law. Give the Levites their dues. He doesn't say give them their dues only if they're righteous or obeying the law. You were supposed to take care of those people. So that's what they were doing. They were still doing that. The apostles were still doing that too. The apostles were also doing tithes and first fruits for their own priests and their own people. They attempted to still bring grain offerings into the temple. The Essenes and apostles, they attempted to do that, but at first they were allowed to do that. So we see in the New Testament, the Acts, Book of Acts, we see Paul in the temple doing a sacrifice. It was a grain offering. But sometime after that, they were banned from the temple and could no longer be there. They could no longer do grain offerings there. And let me see here. Yeah, and basically the Pharisees denounced the Essenes and the apostles and their followers as heretics, and that's why they banned them from the temple. See, but they were still allowed to give them the tithes and first fruits. They just couldn't do their sacrifices there anymore. That's what Josephus says, that they were rejected, Josephus says, from giving the sacrifices there, because they were doing their own sacrifices. That was the reason they stated, Josephus stated. But he also said, but they still brought their dedicated offerings there, and they were received. Now, the question is asked, why would animal sacrifices still be valid? Wouldn't that be Laura is asking this, wouldn't it be an insult to the sacrifice of the Messiah on the cross? She said she was always taught that the Messiah's death did away with animal sacrifices. And that's not what the case. The prophets speak of the sacrifices being done once again. The sacrifices are not just pointless, and they were not for sin either. That's a misunderstanding that's been propagated by bad translations and bad copies of scripture. The animal sacrifices, as we see in the law, were for atonement of physical impurity. We see this in the letter of Hebrews. Hebrews says it is impossible that sin could be taken away from animals, the blood of animals. He does say in Hebrews that the animal sacrifices are powerful and effective for purifying and sanctifying the flesh, the body. So it purifies and sanctifies our bodies. It doesn't save our souls or save us from our sins. That's the Messiah's work. So the Messiah, he does his work by saving us from our sins. And the animals, they do their work by purifying us and healing us, saving us from curses, bodily, physical curses. And as I said, the prophets prophesy that the sacrifices will be restored. The temple's going to be rebuilt. It's going to be what is truly what he desires. The sacrifices were taken away not because Yeshua's sacrifice is better. Even it is better, but that's not why they were taken away. They were taken away because they were being abused. And if they weren't taken away, people wouldn't accept the Messiah's sacrifice. So they were taken away to teach us a lesson that it's not by animal sacrifices which we are saved, It's by his sacrifice, and the animal sacrifices serve another purpose. So they're not incompatible. Another question was asked about the millennial reign, 1,000-year period. It begins the seventh day. The seventh day, 1,000-year period, not the eighth. The eighth day period is the eternal day that lasts forever. And that, or, the eternal age, there's no end to that. And so it's the 6 days, or the 6,000 years. And there's the seventh day, or the seventh 1,000-year period. And then there's the rest of all time, which is the eighth day. So that's what the scriptures tell us, that in the Epistle of Barnabas, for example, and there's another book of Enoch. It's not the main one, it's another one. It's called Second Enoch by scholars, and it says the same thing. It tells us first 6,000 years is the work, that we have to work against the forces of evil, and then the seventh final period is a time of a Sabbath rest where you don't have to fight against the evil forces anymore, because what does Revelation tell us? Satan is locked away for 1,000 years. So, we are not in the seventh day now, because Satan has not been locked away yet, and there is still evil on the earth. We're told in the scriptures that when he comes, he's going to bring in the new age, and everything's going to be good. There's not going to be war anymore. There's going to be peace for all the land. Everyone's going to go to Jerusalem to celebrate the holy days. So, Zechariah 14 speaks of that, where they go to Jerusalem to keep the Feast of Tabernacles, even the Egyptians, all the Gentiles. So we're in the sixth day right now, and we're getting really close to the seventh day. It's from my studies, as I've said in other teachings, he's probably going to be coming back in about 160 years from now, a little around then, from what I could tell from my studies of the math. So we're getting there, but not quite. Now, from the time of the giving of the Holy Spirit on the Messiah's day of Pentecost onward, from that time onward, the apostles began writing down in scrolls accounts of the teachings and visions they received from the Messiah, as well as recording the actions and deeds of the Messiah in scrolls. The apostles began writing letters of instruction to the various congregations that had converted. The apostle Simon Peter, he converted a man named Clement. And Clement was a very special man. He wrote accounts of Peter's teachings, words, and deeds on scrolls as well. During this time, the Jews, in a polemic against the Essenes and the apostles, these Jews began to alter and remove passages of scripture. They started really corrupting the scriptures as a polemic against the new believers, because they were using the scriptures to support the Yeshua as the Messiah. So the Jews started corrupting things as a way of preventing people from finding the truth about who the Messiah truly is. So there was a lot of corruption going on amongst the Jews at this time. Now, the chief enemy of the apostles was named Simon the Magician, or Simon Magus. He was a follower of John the Baptist, and after John had died, Simon usurped the denomination that John had started, and he corrupted John's following into the heretical religion of Gnosticism. This is told to us in some of these writings, the Clement writings. And so Simon, he slandered the apostles and misrepresented their teachings, and through his wickedness, he was able to convert many Gentiles and even some Jews and Samaritans to convert to his religion of Gnosticism. Oh, and by the way, Simon was a Samaritan as well. So Simon's Gnosticism was heavily influenced by the pagan writers Zoroaster, Hermes, Homer, and Plato. And then Simon's religion, Simon Magus, that is, Because he took over the Essene denomination of John the Baptist, his new religion of Gnosticism was a heretical Essene group. So they were from the Essenes, but they were so heretical, like very different from the Essenes, but they had a lot of features that the Essenes did too. That's why some people get confused and think that the Dead Sea Scrolls are Gnostic when they're not. It's a misunderstanding. And they think many of these extra writings are Gnostic too, but that's not the case. Because these writings, which people claim are Gnostic, are opposing the very teachings of Gnosticism in those writings. So, now, from Simon's initial Gnosticism, many later heretics arose and created splinter groups and further denominations of Gnosticism as a result. One of these groups was the Ebionites that came out. And the Essenes and the Apostles and their followers, they all had to fight against these major heresies that were infiltrating the ranks of their converts. Features of Gnosticism, like being against the law, were especially popular with pagan converts. Several years after Paul had been converted and became an apostle, Paul and Barnabas, James, Peter, and many of the apostles were gathered together in Jerusalem and they held a council. Their council concluded that Gentile converts were not required anymore to be circumcised or to keep the Levitical laws. What does Levitical laws mean? It means the animal sacrifices, the sacrifices and everything that has to do with the priesthood and the temple. Those laws were not had to be kept anymore. Why? Because he just rejected their priest and their temple. Not because those laws were done away with, but because their priesthood was considered too corrupt to be allowed to be there anymore. So they took it away. Just like right now, none of us are doing animal sacrifices. Why? Because we can't. Look, it has been disabled because there's no temple there. The priests are no longer ordained. It's not our fault. And this happened because he was giving the Gentiles a chance to come in by having less burdens. So these sacrifices, these Levitical laws, for the time being, not for all time, not when the new temple was built, basically circumcision was not required for converts, and neither was the priest laws. We are still required to do circumcision for the children on the eighth day, but it is my understanding that these documents teach us that after the eighth day, you don't have to be circumcised because there is no temple and no priesthood. The scriptures speak about if you want to participate at Passover, the lamb, you have to be circumcised. If you want to enter the temple area, you have to be circumcised. And it was a command. We must keep Passover and we must enter the holy place. So that's why it was a requirement for people. Even if they weren't circumcised on the eighth day, they still had to be circumcised for the holiness aspect of it. But ever since that was taken away, the holy stuff was removed, that we can't do the temple anymore. For the time being, those laws, specifically for the context of the temple, we can't do anymore and we don't need to do anymore. So circumcision is one of those things. We still are required to do it on the eighth day, but if you don't do it on the eighth day out of disobedience, then there's no way to fix that. According to the law, there's no way to undo that. You are permanently severed from entering the congregation of Israel if you have not been circumcised. So the new covenant gives a way for those people who have not been circumcised to still participate in fellowship in a way that the old covenant did not provide that type of fellowship. But in the new covenant, you can have that type of fellowship even if you haven't been circumcised on the eighth day. You can still fellowship with believers in the holy places of the apostles and their followers. So now, after this time, after that council, Simon the heretic and some of his followers began to write scrolls in the name of the apostles, and they wrote various Gnostic pseudepigrapha, or fake writings in the name of the apostles. Some of these are Gospel of Judas, Apocryphon of John. These were found in the Nag Hammadi library, and there was many other writings too, like Pistis Sophia. That's one of the most evil ones. There were other Gnostic fake writings, which were written in the name of the apostles. This was all the doing of Simon and the heretic and his followers. Now, around 62 AD, Simon the magician was killed by the apostle Simon Peter. Shortly after this, the apostles all gathered together again a second time. Why? Because they decided to hold a secret council. You're not going to find this mentioned in the New Testament, but this is mentioned in the Ethiopian New Testament. The books of the Ethiopian Bible, their extra books, speak of a second council after Acts 15 council. So there was the council in Acts 15, but then there was another council afterwards, which all the apostles gathered together, and they went over the law with everybody, and they settled and established a code for all the believers to follow. And this code would be the new covenant, which was to guide everyone for what's required for their salvation. And so it was at the secret council that the apostles wrote scrolls recording the new law and the terms of the new covenant that the Messiah had revealed to the apostles. The new law and new covenant was written in five distinct scrolls in imitation of the law of Moses. So the apostles wrote a scroll containing an account of the origin of the new law. They wrote a scroll containing an account of the laws for the fellowship. They wrote a scroll containing an account of their reception of the new covenant. They wrote a scroll containing the new law for the priesthood that had been revealed to them. And they wrote a scroll containing a complete overview of the history of the church, and they reviewed with their followers the entire new law that the Messiah had given them, in which they had been teaching their disciples all those years. So also, the apostles at this secret council gathered all the sacred scrolls written by the apostles and their disciples. The scrolls they collected first, they were commanded by God to make many copies in order to share them with all the followers of the apostles. Just in imitation of Ezra. So for the last scrolls that they were gathered, they were commanded by God to make only a few copies of these other scrolls, many other scrolls, in order to share them with only those who prove themselves worthy to have copies of them. Remember, in my other teachings, I taught about the secret scriptures. This is an example where they followed Ezra's command, and the first documents they wrote were going to be shared with everybody. That's the New Testament as we have it. Most of those books were the ones that the apostles said, okay, these books can be shared with everybody. They should be for everybody. But these other books, they're scripture, but they shouldn't be shared with everybody. They have to first prove themselves worthy before they receive a copy. So that's the origin of the New Testament canon and the Old Testament canon too. They wrote down which books would be shared with everybody. All the other books were to be kept secret and only shared with a select few who proved themselves worthy. And there's so many other writings. It's amazing what we're missing. There's so much greater depth from what we have not been told. And it really answers so many questions and reveals so much truth in it. So, all the secret books were known in Greek as the Apocrypha, or the secret books. Apocrypha in Greek is the word that means secret. And that's why we call it the Apocrypha. Clement was handpicked by Simon Peter as his successor, and to be the one who was to have the authority over which sacred scrolls are to be included in the canon, and which sacred scrolls are to be kept secret and shared only with the worthy. So Clement, he was the one who ultimately decided the canon for us. He added some books to the canon, like he added the Revelation of John to the canon after the apostles died. He also added the Shepherd of Hermas. That's what the Shepherd of Hermas tells us. It says, when you write this book about this vision that I'm sharing with you, Hermas, give a copy to Clement, because he is the one who is appointed to distribute these sacred writings to the churches. So this is, Shepherd of Hermas confirms that this is the case. Now there was many reformations and changes made. So many changes that it was going to be called by a new name now. And many people don't think this is the correct name, but I believe it is based on what I've seen. Some of these extra writings speak of it, and I'm very well learned in the language. So what I know to be true, I'm very certain on this, is that Christian, the name Christian, is not pagan. It's not originating from a, you know, there's all different kinds of ideas that people share, but it's actually the Greek translation of the Hebrew word Messiah. Messiah means anointed one, and Christian, or Christ, means anointed one in Greek. And so the followers of the Messiah, they were called Messianics, or, you know, Messiahs. They were followers of the Messiah. And the same thing with in the Greek, they called the same thing. They said, these are Christs, or Christians, followers of the Christ, or, you know, of the Messiah. So that's my understanding of the origin of that term. They weren't originally called that, but that they started being called that, and they preferred to be called by that. And they stopped calling themselves Essenes. And they were called Nazarenes, but only as an insult. Why? Because Nazareth was a place that people belittled as people who originate from there were ridiculed. So they would say, oh, that these are the followers from Nazareth, you know, from the guy, he was a Nazarene. You know, they said that as a repudiating him. So they were called Nazarenes, but that was as an insult. And then later on, the faithful believers were called Nazarenes as an insult by the Christians, and those are the ones who were still keeping the law of Moses. That's my understanding from what I've studied. Now, around 64 AD, Peter and Paul were murdered. And then James was murdered around 69 AD. In 70 AD, due to the nation of the Jews becoming too heretical and wicked, especially in regards to all the murders that they had committed against the righteous people of Israel and their murder of the Messiah, God sent the Romans to destroy the temple of the Jews and to bring most of the Jews into enslaved exile in the Roman Empire. So just like in Babylon, God, when God sent Nebuchadnezzar as punishment for all the murders that they did, that's why the first temple had been destroyed, because they had been so evil and slain the innocent blood. That's what the Old Testament tells us. In the same way, the second temple had been destroyed because of all the wickedness of the Jews in killing innocent people and abominating the holy place. And so he sent the Romans to end it for them. The Essene Jews living at Qumran at this time, they knew that the Romans were about to come and destroy their sacred scrolls. So they hurriedly rushed to hide as many of their scrolls as possible in the caves surrounding their community center. When the Romans came, they destroyed much of the nation of Judah in war, and they destroyed all of the sacred scrolls in the temple, as well as many other sacred scrolls throughout the land of Judah. With the main base of the Essenes destroyed and taken over by the Romans, the Essene Jews were scattered, and this was one of the biggest causes of their religion dying out. Now, there's a question about, did God send the terrorists, or, you know, basically ISIS and ISIL, to kill us? Terrorism, in other words, as punishment for our wickedness? I think partially he did, but partially, you know, there's two coins. There's two sides of the coin. But one side is they're doing it themselves, and they're accountable for their actions, and they're going to be punished for their evil that they're doing. At the same time, he allows this to happen, and sometimes even plans it to happen, because we deserve it. That's what happened in the book of Judges. Whenever the Israelites sinned, they were handed over to the wicked people around them. The Moabites, they were handed over to the Moabites, the Canaanites, and all of the different people. They were subjugated because as punishment for their sins. So I do believe there is some truth to the idea that the terrorism that we see is as a punishment for us. That was asked by Laura. Now, while the Jews were in exile throughout the Roman Empire, because so many of their copies of the scriptures had been lost, they gathered their leaders and arranged for them to make new copies of the scrolls that their people had. So the regular books of the Old Testament. So during this time of collating the scriptures to make new copies, the Jews corrupted their copies even more, and they removed and altered passages to support their own sinful beliefs and wicked agendas. We can prove this by comparing the Masoretic text With the Septuagint, the Dead Sea Scrolls, we can see how they've altered and corrupted the scriptures by removing a lot of doctrines and truth and true passages. They've corrupted those passages. Now, most of the disciples who knew the apostles themselves were faithful to the one true faith. So, you know, all throughout the first century, most of the disciples were faithful. After the apostles died, however, the new converts, not ever having met the apostles themselves, they began corrupting and misinterpreting the words of the apostles. When the disciples who had known the apostles themselves in person rebuked them, these new converts, for disobeying the apostles, the converts were puffed up in knowledge and stubborn, and they refused to submit to the faithful and righteous disciples, but they instead depended on and trusted in their own understanding and interpretation of the scriptures. Once the disciples who had known personally the apostles died, the Christians began falling away from the true faith. However, many Christians continued to keep the law of Moses even at this time, and they were faithful to the teachings of the Essenes and the apostles. But many more Christians were beginning to reject the law of Moses and oppose adherence to it. When Rome destroyed the temple and sent the Jews into exile, they also destroyed most of the sacred scrolls in the land of Judah. This effectively resulted in a huge portion of the scrolls of scripture being lost. The scrolls that remained continued to be used, but the secret scrolls were kept hidden from most church members. It was because of this secrecy that later Christians began to doubt and reject and oppose those secret scriptures as heretical writings and false writings. The church began to suppress the writings and to persecute those who used those secret writings. Later Christians began to destroy most copies of the secret scriptures, the secret scrolls as well. This effectively resulted in the loss of a vast majority of the secret scrolls known to the known world. But the African and Asian churches preserved many of these secret scriptures that were otherwise lost throughout the rest of the world. The African and Asian churches overall were more Torah observant and faithful to the apostles and the Essenes than the European Christians were. Those who continued to keep the law of Moses eventually came to be known by the insulting designation of Nazarene, as I mentioned before. The Nazarene sect faithfully preserved the true faith of the Essene Jews. About 100 years after the time of Constantine, the European Christians adopted a major blasphemous belief, that being the religious position known as diophysitism. There's two positions. There's diophysitism and monophysitism. These were ancient ideas that originated in the 4th century, or excuse me, the 5th century. So the monophysite Christians, they believe there was only one nature of Christ. The diophysites believe there was two natures of Christ. So the monophysites, they broke away from the diophysite Christians, and the monophysites considered the diophysites to be blasphemers and heretics. The basic difference, the main essence of it, is the diophysites believed that the Messiah was divine and human, and that the human part of the Messiah died on the cross, but the God part did not die on the cross, because his God can't die. That's their reasoning. The monophysites considered that heretical. They believed that he was divine and human, but that it was one nature only, not two different natures, and that both aspects of his nature, the divine and human aspect, both of them died on the cross. So it's not two different people where one is not dying on the cross and the other is. It's everything, the entire essence of the Messiah died on the cross. And that's what the monophysites believed. And that's why they broke away. And the Ethiopian writings in the New Testament condemn the diophysites as heretics, blasphemers, falling away from the faith. So they condemn the Catholic Church, because the Catholic Church is diophysite. Now, the monophysite Christians took with them the vast majority of the Nazarenes. So the remnant of true believers was confined to the monophysite churches. Christianity, in its purest, truest, and original form, was almost identical with Essene Judaism, and it came out of it, and was, in fact, simply a denomination of Essene Judaism. So, for this reason, we should still, the true religion is, I believe, still Essene Judaism, even though I also believe Christianity is the true religion, but the term Christianity has suffered a negative connotation. So, to clarify, I tell you, it's Essene Judaism that's the true religion. And the Christianity that has preserved Essene Judaism best is the monophysite Christians that broke away from the Catholic Church in the 5th century AD. So about 500 or so years after the Messiah was born, that's when those people broke away from the Catholic Church. And that's where the true believers went. Where did the Nazarenes go? Where did they go? They disappeared. They didn't entirely disappear. They went with these Christians for asylum and safety. They went so they could still survive and follow the teachings of the truth. And so there was a lot of Law of Moses observance amongst these Christians, continuing the Nazarene. So basically, when the Essenes died out, the Nazarenes continued to preserve, in an albeit corrupted form, the Essene Judaism faith, and the Nazarenes, when they eventually died out, the monophysite churches continued to preserve, in an albeit corrupted form, the Nazarene Judaism faith. Now, during this time of darkness, Muhammad, a false prophet, came onto the scene in fulfillment of the prophecy of the Apostle Peter. Islam was not something that just happened. It was actually prophesied of by the Apostle Peter in some of these other writings. And so, when Muhammad came onto the scene, that false prophet, he created a heretical religion known as Islam, and Islam was derived from monophysite Christianity. That's why Muslims don't believe in the Trinity, they don't believe in the deity of the Messiah, because they come out of the monophysite mindset, and the Jewish mindset as well. Now, Muhammad gained many followers, and his followers persecuted and murdered many Christians and many of the true believers in the monophysite church. There was great darkness and oppression and evil in these times. So God, we're getting close to the end of this teaching, so I'm going to try to wrap this up. Now, so God, seeing these things, was extremely displeased. Out of mercy, seeing how corrupted the faith was, and how few people knew the truth and were able to be saved, and how wicked the world had become, God sent an angel to the dog of an Arab Bedouin man. The angel led the dog to a bunch of caves in the Dead Sea region near Jericho. The owner of the dog followed it and was led right into the cave that the dog had been led to. And in that cave, the man found, in Hebrew, scrolls of the Old Testament as well as other sacred scrolls written in Hebrew. These scrolls corroborated the Septuagint and also had many extra books of prophecy that the New Testament quoted from. Among these Apocrypha scrolls were found more than 200 Psalms of David, as well as scrolls of Enoch, Moses, the patriarchs, Gad, Nathan, Ahijah, Shemaiah, Solomon, and the Damascus document. So a lot of extra writings were found at this time. This was about 1,000 years ago. There was a great revival amongst some of the monophysite Christians at this time. New books were read as scripture, and people were finding the ancient ways once again. Christians from all over the monophysite churches began using the various secret books with much greater confidence, because they said, well, the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found, they support these extra books, so maybe we should start using them. So more people started using them. Again, this was 1,000 years ago. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church, in particular, they were the most open and receptive to the teachings of these ancient scrolls of the Dead Sea that had been found. And so it was that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, as well as other Oriental Orthodox churches, or monophysite churches, it was for this reason that they became great beacons of light in an age of darkness, you know, the Dark Ages. They were great beacons of light at this time. But as the years went on, these Christians, these Oriental Orthodox, they began to become more corrupt once again and fall away from the truth of the Nazarenes and the Essenes that had been found in the scrolls. And God was silent for many years, but as wickedness increased and knowledge more and more began to fall away, God decided once again to help us restore the true faith and return to the ancient paths. And in his mercy, around the time of the Protestant Reformation, he sent angels to guide the pagans and heretics to begin finding the scrolls of the Apocrypha, which had been lost and gone missing. Every century since the Protestant Reformation, they have been making major discoveries of various lost scrolls and books of the Apocrypha scriptures. God then sent angels to lead people to return to observance of the law of Moses, and this stirred a revival of the Nazarene movement, albeit a highly corrupted version of the ancient Nazarenes. In the 20th century, God sent an angel to a bird and led it into a cave. An Arab Bedouin followed the bird into the cave so that he could retrieve the bird. And when he went in, he saw the scrolls, but the man decided to just leave the scrolls there. Then in 1948 AD, God sent an angel to lead a goat into a cave in the region of the Dead Sea near Jericho. An Arab Bedouin followed the goat, and he found many scrolls, and this was called Cave 1 by scholars of the Dead Sea Scrolls. The man gathered the scrolls and told others about what he had found. In 1952 AD, the man who had followed the bird into a cave those many years prior told his friends about his experience with the bird and where the cave was. They followed the man's directions and found many scrolls in the cave, just as the man had said. This was called Cave 4 by scholars. So from the years 1948, hold on one second. Someone's calling me on Skype. So, from the years 1948 to 1956, 11 caves in total with texts were found in the Dead Sea region near Jericho, all in very close vicinity to one another. And these scrolls became known as the Dead Sea Scrolls. So, God sent angels to orchestrate also the restoration of the nation of Judah. And this resulted in the nation of Judah being created in the same year that Cave 1 of the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered. So the nation of Israel today was restored in the same year as the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, 1948. That's not a coincidence. And after the scrolls were found, most of the scrolls had been stolen by the Arab Bedouins. Over a period of many years, the nation of Judah bought and thus acquired most of the Dead Sea Scrolls fragments that had been found. In 1967, the nation of Judah, or Israel, they forcibly took from an Arab Bedouin the temple scroll during this very week that the nation acquired the temple scroll. The Six-Day War was fought and resulted with the nation of Judah capturing Jerusalem. Thus, for the first time in 1900 years, the Jews were in control, finally, of Jerusalem. And they still are to this day. Despite the Dead Sea Scrolls being discovered in a small amount of time, it took many decades for all the Dead Sea Scrolls to be shared with the public. This was due to reasons of greed. Around 1991, in the year I was born, the Dead Sea Scrolls were given to the public. They were freed. And in 2009, I came to the realization that the Law of Moses is still required to be kept for salvation. Also, in this year, I discovered the existence of the Apocrypha Scriptures, and over several years, I searched for all the Apocrypha Scriptures that I could find. That's something that's very much on my heart. I've been studying that and searching for these lost writings. In 2011, after much study and seeking for the truth, I came to the conclusion that the Dead Sea Scrolls were the key to restoring the true faith and the key to returning to the ancient ways of the Messiah and the Apostles. And in this year, I came to the conclusion, in 2011 that is, that the religion of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the religion of Essene Judaism, was indeed the one true religion. And so I accepted at that time all the Dead Sea Scrolls as a scripture, and I still do to this day. So with my conversion to the religion of Essene Judaism, I believe the restoration of the true faith has finally been set into motion. And so after 1900 years, people, Essene Judaism has finally been restored. I believe I've restored it, finally. But it's so it's no longer a dead religion, but it is now full of life and spirit and truth. But there's very few who follow this way, so my mission now is to restore their religion to its former glory and spread it throughout the world. I believe I am a key leader and chief of the one true faith in these last days, and I feel it is my duty and moral obligation to restore that faith of the Essenes, the Dead Sea Scrolls, and to lead people to salvation through that Essene way. And I believe I am also chosen as a scribe to restore God's word to its fullness and to make the Dead Sea Scrolls to be the basis of the most authoritative and complete version of the Bible. That's what my Bible project is working on right now. I am working on that. I've been doing that for several years, and it's making great progress, but it's still going to be a long time for the Bible project to be finished. So I believe Essene Judaism will be a key game changer and influencing force in the Hebrew Roots movement and amongst Torah observant believers in these last days. Ever since 2009, the movement of believers returning to Torah observance has soared in very high numbers, and it is spreading like wildfire. So as people return to Torah observance, they are being led astray into Pharisee Judaism and Sadducee Judaism, I believe. So the restoration of Essene Judaism in these times is crucial and critical to preventing people from becoming Messianic Pharisees and Messianic Sadducees to the loss of their eternal souls. Because I believe if you follow the Pharisee or Sadducee way, you won't be saved, but you have to follow the Essene way. And so I believe Essene Judaism alone is a true observance of the law of Moses, and that any other groups are not keeping the law truly, but they're in great sin, and they're deceived by heresies and blasphemies. So I believe it's also the one true religion, and no other religion is true. And so now that has been restored, I believe it's time for everyone everywhere to repent and change their ways so they can be saved from their sins. So this is my mission, this is the gospel, I believe. So in a world of darkness and utter damnation for most of the world, I believe the Essene Judaism faith is now the sole beacon of light and is the perfectly pure and it is perfect, I think, their faith. So I really think we should be looking at this stuff and incorporating it into our lives. But so anyways, that's the end of this teaching today. Let me see. Yeah, so I hope you guys enjoyed it. Any final questions? Otherwise, I'm going to end it for this week. And for those who join in later, this is recorded, so you can catch up later. All right. For you, as I said, some of you guys missed some of the parts, so if you please, when I load it to YouTube, re-listen if you like, and thank you so much for attending. Hope to see you next week. Shalom to you all.